This is Pastor Kurt. Before we get into virtual church today, I wanted to share with you that this day, January 3rd, we're beginning 21 days of prayer and fasting. I'm asking you to join me to pray for our nation, to pray for our city, to pray for our church, to pray for our people, to pray for our families, and it's surely to pray for yourselves. I think it's at a time right now at the beginning of this new year to start off the year on a spiritual, important time where we draw near to the Lord and let Him draw near to us. So I'm asking you to pray. I'm asking you to spend more time in prayer, spend more time in the Word. I'm asking you to spend more time thinking about God, engaging with the Lord, and letting the Lord engage with you. So will you join me over these next 21 days? I'm not telling you what to fast. Certainly fasting is a great thing for us because we give up something in order to glean something more important. And what is that more? What's more important? It's spiritual sensitivity, hearing the voice of the Lord. And so I'm asking you today to join me in prayer. And let's pray that God is going to do a wonderful, great thing in our lives, in our nation, in our world. And certainly all the pandemic and all the other issues that we're facing, it's time that the people of God pray. So join me. So as we're heading into these 21 days, today's message talks about prayer and it talks about being on the offense in prayer. And I think it'll be a challenge for us all because it's been a challenge to me personally. But before we get into that, I wanted to share with you something that took place this last December. And that is our kids, many of our kids, got these kits and they put together a gingerbread nativity. And I thought it would be fun to share those pictures with you. Let's take a look at them now and then we're going to go right into our service. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to Virtual Church here at New Hope Christian Fellowship. It's good to have you with us on this very special day. We're going to be starting our season of prayer, as well as at the end of our service today, we're going to be sharing communion together. So I hope that you will prepare your hearts for what God is going to do in you in a very special way. Well, I'm going to start off just a little differently today because I want to share my message. And as I'm sharing my message, it's going to lead us into our time of worship. And so I want you to prepare yourself for what God is going to bring to your heart. I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 21, verses 21 through 22. And as you're turning there, I want to share with you that I was just listening to Dallas Willard here recently. And Dallas Willard said something really interesting. He said this, "Are we preaching a gospel that produces disciples? Or are we simply preaching to produce consumers of religious goods and services?" Can I say that one more time? Are we preaching a gospel that produces disciples? Or are we simply preaching to produce consumers of religious goods and services? You see, he is so right. I think in our modern Christianity, we have raised up people that are simply consumers of religiosity when God has called us to be disciples. And he says as much. He says, go into all the world and make disciples. And so today we're going to focus on what it means to be people of prayer and people of disciples. Let's pray together, first of all. Lord, I pray that you will bless our time, that you will open our hearts, that you will transform our lives. And Lord, let us see what you see. Let the goodness of God reign in us in your great name. Amen. Amen. Thanks, Debbie. I appreciate it. Well, we are focusing on what it means to be a disciple, not just a religious consumer. You know what a religious consumer is? They go around looking for the latest fad. But we want to be a person who follows after the Lord Jesus Christ. I've been in the music ministry for many years before I became a pastor, and I've led many groups of musicians and so on. And I discovered in that time, and I think it's true for any organization, there's an image of an apple that I think gives us how an organization is divided up. An apple. You see, at the core of the apple is the core. And the apple in that core is where the seed is. And I think as the apple has a core, that we as a church and organizations as a whole, they have a core group of people. They're the ones who really make things happen. We couldn't exist without the people who are the core. Because of the core, the apple is able to take form. Because of the core, everything in the apple is built out. You have the meat and you have the peel. So the core is very important. Those are the people that are just dead set. They're sold out. They're engaged. And then it's interesting to note that in the core of the apple, that's where the seed is. The seed that you could take and you could plant elsewhere and produce an apple tree. The core, that's very important. The second group of people in the apple analogy here is the meat. It's the meat of the apple. And the meat is vital for the health of the apple. And is that what the meat does is it allows the core and indeed allows the whole apple to carry on and to move forward as an organization. They come alongside the core and they're solely involved with what's going on in terms of the apple. Maybe not as much as the core, but nevertheless very important to the apple. And then you have the third group of people that I quite lovingly call the peels. Yes, the peels. They are the ones that are loosely attached. It's interesting, many people just peel off the peel before they eat the apple because they're afraid maybe the apple has some contaminants on its peel. Well, we have certainly within the church organization and in indeed any organization, we have the peels. In music ministry, the peels were the ones they would show up for the main events, you know, Christmas and Easter and the special concerts. They would show up to do those things, but the nuts and bolts of the music ministry was carried on by the core and by the meat. The peels, they showed up to get the glory, all right? The peels. As you could tell, the peels are difficult because I love them, they're dear, but when it comes to counting on the peels, you can't really count on them because they're here today and they're gone tomorrow. They're there for the glory. They're not there in the trenches. And so the peel is a group of people that every organization has. And indeed, we have two. So we have a core group of people, we have the meat people, and we have the apple peel people. I think Dallas Willard said it well, that there are those who are indeed involved with the discipleship. And I would call those the core and the meat people. And then there are those who are consumers of religious stuff. And the religion, they're part of religion as a part of their life and not their whole life. And those are the peels. And I think what I'm appealing to you today, as we begin this 21 days of prayer, I'm appealing to you to grow in your relationship with the Lord and engage with the power of God to transform your prayer life so that your life can be transformed from being a peel in Christ to being part of the meat and part of the core of Christ. And over these next 3 weeks, I want to deal with the aspect of having a prayer life that is an offense, not a defense, but an offense. I think it's time that Christians would rise up and take an offensive stance when it comes to fighting the evil one. Offense is important when it comes to sports. It's the offense that scores points. Now, I certainly know that defense can score as well. But when it comes down to big scores, if you don't have a strong offense, you're not going to win games. Now, what's the difference between offense and defense? Particularly in prayer, as we're going to relate this to prayer, what's the difference between offense and defense? It's this one simple truth. The offense has the ball. The defense wants it back. The offense has the ball. And because the offense has the ball, The offense can determine what they do with the ball. In terms of football, they can determine whether to run or they can determine to pass. If it's in baseball, the pitcher is delivering the ball to the batter, and the batter can take an offensive stance with that ball. He could determine to hit it or determine not to hit it. He can determine where to hit it. He can determine how far he wants to hit it. Because that ball is in his court, in essence, if he was in tennis, he's able to determine where that ball goes and what that ball does. Let me tell you something. I think Christians in our realm, in our world, and let me just Christians in America have been playing defense when we should be playing offense. We have the opportunity to determine where the ball goes, and we need to take that stance and move forward with it. Even in volleyball, when you're playing volleyball, you have the opportunity to lob that ball over the net or spike it over the net. You have the options with the ball. Let me share with you emphatically, in our Christian walk, you have the options to do in the Spirit what needs to be done, and you can do it because we need to take the offense. Why? Because our purpose is to score souls for the kingdom. So many of us are playing defense. We're spending our time trying to figure out what the enemy is doing when it should be what the opposite. It should be what the enemy is trying to figure out what the offense is doing. We should be throwing the defense off guard, not so much throwing the defense off guard. We need to do that so that we can know this. We have the ball. Listen to me, Christians. We have the ball. How do I know? Because God has given us the ball. Now, there is a time to play defense, but the victory is won in offense. The victory is won as we take the ball and we run with it. You know, Jesus played defense for a while. When he was here on earth, he submitted himself. He even submitted himself to death, even death on a cross. He submitted himself to Pilate. He was playing, in essence, defense because there was a purpose that he had in playing defense. But something happened when he was placed in the grave. What was it? He turned the ball and he became offensive. He rolled the stone away. He rose from the grave. He called the disciples. He ascended into heaven. He began to work the church and call the church to go and make disciples. Disciples of all nations, that they would have an impact. It looked for a while that he was like Rocky on the ropes, but he came back. And there that eye of the tiger, that slogan goes, that eye of the tiger came into play, and he was able to take the offensive. He took the keys of death, hell, and the grave. And now he's up in heaven and he's preparing the mighty army to come back with him in a great offensive stance against evil, where he's going to play down evil, he's going to destroy evil, he's going to establish his kingdom, and we are going to live forever and ever in him. And while he's gone, guess what he's given to us? He's given us the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, that we would be able to advance the kingdom of God because of the Holy Spirit in us. And it's an advance that is offensive. Are you getting me? Advancing. We're moving forward in him. And frankly, I think our prayer life needs to reflect that. Our prayer life needs to come to this place where we are offensive in our prayers, not defensive in our prayers. Which brings me to Matthew chapter 21. Verses 21 through 22, where he says, "And Jesus answered them, 'Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what has been done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, it will happen.'" Notice the affirmative there. "And whatever you ask in prayer, you will receive if you have faith." Now, we've defined faith many a time. Faith is not a wish. Faith is just not something that comes along and you hope it takes place. Faith is something that comes as a result of the Word of God that is spoken to us. And he gave us the ability to pray for people and to speak the Word so that we can go out and in the offense and take the kingdom and plunder, I should say, the kingdom of evil for the kingdom of God. God has given us that call to be disciples. He's given us that call to go and tread into the evil's camp and take back that which belongs to God. And what is it that belongs to God? The souls. He did not give us the call to go out and build big houses. And he did not give us the call to go out and get rich so we would never have to work again. He didn't give us the call to even formulate political action committees and see politics change, although I have nothing against that when it comes to citizens. But if we're talking about the church, our primary call is to go out and make disciples for the kingdom, disciples for the Lord Jesus Christ. I, in essence, calling us to do what Jesus called us to do, and that is to be an army of God, to plunder the devil's camp and bring back those who are captive in the enemy's chains, and they've been downtrodden by the enemy's tactics, and today they are defeated. But the Lord has come that we would be empowered by the Spirit and indeed big more than conquerors for the Lord Jesus Christ. He gave us that authority. Yes, he did. And it's our call to go and make a difference for the kingdom of God. We are to go into the kingdom of this world so that we can make a difference for the kingdom of God. This is the focus of our existence. This is why we're here. This is why we belong to Christ, so that we can plunder hell. That's what somebody said that. Plunder hell for the kingdom of God. I was looking online at some different things, and I found a song written by Helen Baylor, and it's called Sold Out. Allow me to share with you some of the words. She said, "Carnal things don't amount to nothing. Won't look back, my hands to the plow, and I'm running. For the life of me, I can't figure it out why you want to be half-stepping. Why don't you want to sell out?" Boy, I like that. And then her chorus says, "I'm sold out." By the way, I can't sing it like she does. "I'm sold out to Jesus. I'm sold out for Jesus." And then she says, "I can count it all joy when I face the fiery tribulations. My God has given me all the power to overcome temptation." The Bible says faith with works is dead, so dead. Just like Nehemiah told Sanballat, these are the words he said. "I'm sold out for Jesus. I'm sold out for Jesus." And then she continues on in that metaphor of Nehemiah building the wall. And she says, "I'm not coming off the wall. No, I've got too much work to do. I'm not coming off the wall, not until my labor is through. I'm sold out to Jesus." The Lord is asking us to be sold out for him and take the offensive because of the power of the Holy Spirit that is within us. I'd like to turn to Joshua chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 1 through 10. And over these next couple of weeks, we're going to be analyzing what God told Joshua and how that relates to our own personal call to take authority in the spiritual realms. So let's start with chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, 'Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land I'm giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set your foot, you will be on land that I have given you. From the Negev wilderness in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north, from the Euphrates River in the east to the Mediterranean Sea in the west." I want you to grasp how big that property is, including all of the land of the Hittites. "No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you." Look at that. "As I was with Moses, I will not fail you. I will not abandon you." Going on to verse 6, he says, "Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors I would give them. Be strong and courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do." I want you to see those terms. He says, "Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And we'll end it with verse 10. Joshua then commanded the officers of Israel. Well, there's some bullet points here from Joshua chapter 1 that I think are important for us. And like I said, we'll take a look at a couple today and then we'll look at the rest next week. Number one, the first bullet point is this. Make sure that you are under authority. Make sure that you are under authority. God comes and says, Moses, my servant, is dead. Every time I read that phrase, I think of the starkness of that statement. It's like God is telling Joshua, I don't know what was going on in Joshua, but I can only imagine, what are we going to do? I wish Moses was here. I wish Moses was here to help me. Things went better when Moses was here. But God comes and emphatically says, listen, the old is gone, the new is here, and you are going to lead them forward. I want you, Joshua, to pick up, and it's time for you to lead. It came from an anointing that came onto him. If you read back in Numbers, it talks about Joshua was anointed in order to follow Moses, and now his time had come. It was time for him to lead. It was time to exercise the authority that God had given him. Romans chapter 5, verse 17 says, for the sin of one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of righteousness. Now look at this. For all who receive it will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. If there's anything that Jesus has given to us, it's victory over sin, victory over death. It's time that we as Christians do what Joshua did back then. He began to exercise his authority to go in and take the land. But you know what we have? We have the blessing of Jesus Christ, who has given us authority that we would triumph over sin, that we would be victorious over sin. Acts chapter 19, verses 11 through 16 says it well. He says, and God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul. This is an interesting passage. You see, Paul was being used by God to go and do tremendous miracles. But something happened in this wonderful story that I want to share with you. It goes, so even handkerchiefs or aprons that had touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. But notice this, the evil spirits came out because of the anointing that was on Paul. Let's move on. Verse 13, then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits. They saw the power that was working in Paul, and so they began to mimic Paul. And how do they know that? They begin to say this, I adjure you by Jesus whom Paul proclaims. It wasn't their authority. It wasn't Jesus' authority. They were invoking an incantation of what Paul would do, hoping that the same thing would happen to them. Well, what happened? Seven sons of the Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. But the evil spirit answered them. They tried this incantation on an evil spirit. And I love this line. Jesus I know, and Paul I recognize, but who are you? And the man in whom the evil spirit leaped on them and mastered all of them and overpowered them so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. Now remember, the point is this. We need to be under authority. Why? Because if you're not under authority, then the authority's power does not work through you. And you are subjected to all of the wiles of the evil, even though you try. But if you're not under authority, if you're not under God's authority, all of the work that you do will not happen. You'll end up running out naked because the evil spirit will come upon you. We have to live under the authority of God in order to exercise that authority. You know, if we go back to the football analogy, you know, if you're going to have the authority of the team, you have to be part of the team. You have to show up for practice. You have to learn the plays. You have to encourage the others that are on your team. You have to submit to the coach. You see, those are things that you do when you're under authority. In our case, we submit ourselves to Christ. We listen to Christ. We graft His word into our hearts. We exercise the authority and the power and the faith that God has given to us. And when we do that, it builds up our strength under that authority so that we can indeed do as the passage says, speak to mountains and they move, or speak to demons and they run. We have to take authority. But understand this, Zechariah reminds us, it's not by might and it's not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. I'm encouraging you this day, I'm encouraging you right now, submit to God's authority. I'm going to have to save the rest for later. And I want you to understand this, that God will give you the strength. God will give you the power so that our prayers will be transformed. Not prayers of weakness. And James tells us that if we believe and if we doubt and if we're wavering in our belief, our prayers will not be answered. He says we need to have this assurance that God's power is working through us, His word that speaks life to us. And in speaking life to us, we can know His power in us to, in order to affect the kingdom of God in our world. It's time that we pray. It's time that we pray in authority, and it's time that we pray in the power of the Holy Spirit. Why? Because God is doing a work through us. He's not just doing it, He has chosen. He has chosen to work through us in our prayers, in our activity. And you know what? It comes down to the very bottom line is, do I believe or not? Do I believe or not? And we have to understand there is a belief that rises up within us as we point ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ and live by His power and live by His authority. I want you to know God's work is not done. No, God's work is not done. And you know what? I rebuke those of us who say, you know what? I just want to sit back and make it to heaven. No, God has called us to impact this world for Christ. And when we live under His authority, understand all the power that the Holy Spirit gives to us is there for us to activate in our own life to where we could speak and things happen. Why? Because God is doing incredible things in our midst. And there's a song that, I remember when I first came here to Vacaville, the church used to sing this all the time. And I just want to reinstitute it back in here, that there are greater things that the Lord is doing. There are greater things that God is getting ready to do. And I'm telling you one thing, I'm ready to see it done. I know many people have talked about 2020, and thank God 2020 is in the past. But how are we going to make 2021 different? If we keep doing what we did in 2020, how is 2021 going to be different? I think this. I think God allowed 2020 in order to prepare us for 2021. God allowed us to go through some of the struggles and the purifying process and to reassess our priorities, so that we can go into 2021 with greater strength and greater power, greater authority, that we would be able to confront the evil one and watch him run. Not that we would see some bill passed in government, which has its place, but that we would see the church ignited for the Lord Jesus Christ, and as a result of that burning fire, see a world that is transformed for the Lord Jesus Christ. What is the gospel? That Jesus Christ came and died for our sins so that we might have life and life to the full. Greater things the Lord is doing in our life. I want you to sing this song, and I want you to let it sink into your heart, and I want it to let it burn in your spirit, and recognize this, there are great things God is getting ready to do through you. Let's sing it together. Greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of the city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in the darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. That's right. There is no one like our God. Declare it here. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. And greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of the city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in the darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. As we move into the core, we know that God is going to use us and God is going to do some great things. Why? Because He is great. I want you to proclaim with me. Here we go. All creation cries to you, worshiping in spirit and in truth. Glory to the faithful one, Jesus Christ, God. Who for the glory of the name of Jesus Christ. It's no longer time to be peels. This is not the time to be a peel. It's time to move into the core. It's time to have and make a difference in the spiritual realm. And God will use you wherever you are, no matter who you are, no matter what you do, God will use you to affect His kingdom. Which gives me an understanding of what communion is all about today. Communion is all about connecting with the Lord. And so today we're going to be receiving communion. And if you remember right, communion is very important for the saints. Communion tells us how Jesus took the offense. He gave His blood. He gave His body. He plundered hell. Communion reminds us of the victory that we have in Jesus Christ. And I want to share with you, it's the same victory that we need to live in today. We're not downtrodden. I love David. He says, "Why so downcast, O my soul?" We're not downtrodden. We're the people of purpose, the people of victory. And God has called us. And when we receive communion, we are on the team of the Lord. We're under His authority. Well, I wish I had time to talk about the rest of it. Well, I'll just have to wait till next week. But if we're going to be effective, it's going to be because we're under His authority. We are enabled by His power and His Spirit in us to live and to act by the authority of Jesus Christ. Let's receive communion today. The body, of course, represents the bread represents the body of Christ. The juice represents the blood that was shed for us. And we are joining Christians all over the world. I want to remind you that the army of the Lord is vast. It's all over the world. And we are partaking with them to show an identity, a unity of heart, and of course, connecting with the Lord. So Lord, we say thank you today for the body that was broken, the blood that was shed, the life flow that comes from you. We thank you for the victory that we have. We have victory over death, hell, and the grave, and we have something to look forward to tomorrow. But yet, Lord, you strengthen us even for today. We have peace today. I pray that you will bless our time. Bless this moment in Jesus' name. Amen. Break the bread and give a piece to whoever's with you, and then eat some yourself. Take the juice. Go ahead and say thank you, Lord. Yeah, go ahead and say thank you, Lord. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way. Things that we enjoy as a result of the sacrifice of the Lord is the ability to pray, and He hears our prayers. So I want to do just that. Lord, I pray that you will touch people. Touch, I pray, that the power of your love touch, power of your strength touch, the goodness of God touch. Lord, we need you to move. I pray that there would be victory. Souls would be set free. There would be minds that have been oppressed. Lord, set them free. There are those in the midst of despair. Set them free today. We declare the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask in your name, the authority of your name that brings victory. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
I want to remind you too that this is a good time to begin reading the Word. The beginning of every year, you need to read the Word every year. And get a Bible record, maybe something like this. We have these at the church. Or get something on your own, just something to hold yourself accountable. I use this one myself. And I check off every day so that I make sure that I read the Bible through every year. And if you want to join me, get a record. You can get them online. You can get them anywhere. But hold yourself accountable. There are some that go right straight through. There are some that read some from the Old Testament, some the New Testament, some from the Psalms. There's just a myriad of different ways. What's important is that you read the Word, let it be grafted into your heart, and let the Lord Jesus Christ change your life. Finally, I want to say thank you for your giving. Your giving makes all the difference. And thank you for being so faithful in 2020. I'm praying that 2021, not only will we see COVID subside, and that we pray for the heart of America, that America will be transformed, but I pray that you will allow, that the Lord will allow New Hope to just continue to prosper and see souls come to Jesus in this moment. With all that being said, I just want to bless you. And it comes from Colossians. This has been the blessing I've been reading the past couple of weeks. So let me continue to read it. It says this. So we have not stopped praying for you since we first heard about you. We ask God to give you complete knowledge of His will and to give you spiritual wisdom and understanding. Then the way you live will always honor and please the Lord, and your lives will produce every kind of good fruit. All the while, you will grow as you learn to know God better and better. And we also pray that you will be strengthened with all His glorious power so that you will have all the endurance and patience you need. May you be filled with joy, always thanking the Father. We pray this over you in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week.